my mic was on. Number 383, the summons will start. 383. Will you come and follow me if I but call your name? Will you go where you don't know and never be the same? Will you love me, show? Will you let my name be known? Will you let my life be grown in you and you in me? And the Lord has gathered us together to praise him in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And as we gather before the Word of God this morning, let's reflect on the times that we don't kind of live life carefully and mindfully, the times we miss things or aren't looking to see God, and a lot of things that mystify us or threaten us or just mystify us. And for the times we don't have that deep faith that God is the one in whom we live and move and have our being, we ask the Lord for the embrace of divine mercy. Holy God, you are ever-present to every breath and experience of our life. And yet sometimes we simply don't look for you there and don't therefore see you. And we ask your forgiveness as we pray, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sin, and bring us unto life everlasting.
Amen.
Let us pray. O Lord, grant that as we celebrate the mystery, the solemnities of your Son's resurrection, so we too may worthily rejoice at his coming with all the saints. And we ask you this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit as our one God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. After Paul's escorts had taken him to Athens, they came away with instructions for Silas and Timothy to join him as soon as possible. Then Paul stood up at the Areopagus and said, "You Athenians, I see that in every respect you are very religious. For as I walked around looking carefully at your shrines, I even discovered an altar inscribed to an unknown God. What therefore you unknowingly worship, I proclaim to you, the God who made the world and all that is in it, the Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in sanctuaries made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands because he needs anything. Rather, it is he who gives to everyone life and breath and everything. He made from one the whole human race to dwell on the entire surface of the earth, and he fixed the ordered seasons and the boundaries of their regions so that people might seek God, even perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your poets have said, for we too are his offspring. Since therefore we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the divinity is like an image fashioned from gold, silver, or stone by human art or imagination. God has overlooked the times of ignorance, but now he demands that all people everywhere repent, because he has established a day on which he will judge the world with justice through a man he has appointed. And he has provided confirmation for all by raising him from the dead." When they heard about resurrection of the dead, some began to scoff. But others said, "We should like to hear you on this some other time." And so Paul left them. But some did join him and became believers. Among them were Dionysius, a member of the court of the Areopagus, a woman named Damaris, and others with him. After this, he left Athens and went to Corinth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all you angels. Praise him, all you his hosts.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Let the kings of the earth and all peoples, the princes and all the judges of the earth, young men too and maidens, old men and boys.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His majesty is above earth and heaven.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory.
He has lifted up the horn of his people. Be this his praise from all his faithful ones, from the children of Israel, the people close to him. Alleluia.
Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you always. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you. The reading is taken from the Holy Gospel according to John. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "I have much more to tell you, but you cannot bear it now. But when he comes, the Spirit of truth, he will guide you to all truth. He will not speak on his own, but he will speak what he hears and will declare to you the things that are coming. He will glorify me because he will take from what is mine and declare it to you. Everything that the Father has is mine. And for this reason, I told you that he will take from what is mine and declare it to you." The Gospel of the Lord. As we begin to enter the Easter, close the Easter season, and then celebrate the Ascension and the giving of the Spirit, that starts tomorrow. You know, it's interesting what the Gospel readings are saying. And one is Jesus, who keeps saying, "I'm going to send you an advocate, someone who's going to tell you the truth, who's going to awaken you to how God is continuing to reveal not only everything I told you, but everything I want you to know, which will be learned from your life experience, because I'm present all over it." And so there's a kind of an inner truth that we have to kind of access. We call it the divine indwelling, the dwelling of the Trinity, however language we use, but it's about God within us that is resonating with God that is all over, the God in whom we live and move and have our being, as Paul keeps saying. And so I think we have to learn to live attentively and listen carefully to life. You know, God is constantly revealing to us in our life, and I think that's what he's trying to say, you know, is how do we understand that divine presence that is all over the place? One of the geniuses of Paul, and especially Paul here in the Areopagus, which is wonderful, I'm going to be there in about 4 weeks, you know, on the Hill of Mars, which is, you know, in Athens there. But when he goes there, what's interesting, if you watch him, you know, he's a sharp cookie. He was highly controversial, but what he did, and you have to see the physicality of what he's doing. He's standing up on, like, where, you know, the Acropolis is. You've all seen pictures of that. And the Areopagus is right next to it. It's the court of the wise elders, actually. It's where they have a supreme court that made moral judgments, not legal judgments. And so he starts talking to them. It's the Hill of Mars. But anyway, when he's looking down, what he had just seen below it is the Forum. It was the heart of Athens at the time.
And what is there? It's the marketplace. It's where all commerce took place. The legal stuff took place, but also where all their temples were. There are hundreds of temples and statues to all these gods and goddesses, because they had a real sense of a god for everything. You know, they had the divine everywhere. But instead of Paul making fun of it, which right away he said, oh, you got all these statues, he said, you know, God is everywhere. You know, God is even closer than those statues. He attacks them. He says, I don't think it's all this individual little people. You got to keep this one happy for this and this one happy for that. You know, this is, and he even says, you notice you've got the unknown God. You even know enough that there's more to this than this panoply of all these gods and goddesses you have made of silver and marble and gold and bronze and all that stuff. And so he says to that, but we have the God that is revealed, the God I'm speaking of that is fleshed in Jesus, is the God who doesn't dwell in sanctuaries made by human hands. It's a God who has become human, but not made by human man's way, by God. And this is the God who breathes life into everything, that this God is all over the place. So then he uses that wonderful line, the God in whom we live and move and have our being, which is what a Greek poet had said. He's pulling from them. He has a sensitivity. Rather than judging things as wrong, he takes it and says, look, you're a holy people. You see the God everywhere. And what we want to do is that there's more. There's this God, this unknown God, who is the God of all gods, who is the presence that is deep within and all around. And I think we have to have, we who deep within know this truth that the Spirit of Jesus gives us, we have to kind of see the world that way, which means we have to understand what Paul said, that we're the offsprings of God. You know, a lot of Christians and Catholics for some reason don't think we're children of grace. We think we're children of sin and evil. People tell you that all the time. You're not really in touch with God, are you? You know, go to confession and you're a sinner, you're separated. Instead of that, you're graced, which is what the revelation is about, that God embraces all of us in the person of Jesus, who becomes the Christ, and that we are the living Christ today. And so this, that we have to somehow understand this God within us who wants to reach out to the world around us and see what God sees when he sees all this, which is not being judgmental, but it's being embracing. There's all ways in which I'm revealing myself to them. And so I think you have to look at that. We have to listen to Paul carefully. Do you believe you're an offspring of God? Ask yourself seriously about that. You know, we believe we're baptized. We're baptized into Christ, God. Do you see the divinity within you? You are not God, but that God dwells in us and we dwell in God, period. That's what it's all about. That was her great insight. It's all grace. That's the way she said it. Everything is grace. Or do we have hearts of stone that depend simply on our own human judgment, our own human, as he says, gold, silver, human art, or imagination? Or do we let God speak through us, as Paul did? He saw something bigger when a lot of other Christians went running around saying, look what you got down there, all that trash. We got to break it and destroy it. And he said, oh, isn't that a wonderful sign? See, he saw the positive in it. It was all a manifestation of the divine. And yet he said, there's more. What's inside that? And if we don't know what's inside us, we're not going to know what's inside human life. If anything, when we should pray, it has to sink us into the God in whom we live and move and have our being. Do you see yourself living and breathing and acting through a graced universe, an enchanted world? Watch your judgments about the people you meet, the things that happen to you today. It'll tell you whether you think you live in a graced and enchanted world, in the God in whom we live and move and have our being. Because one of the reasons we come to Eucharist is not to keep God happy, it's so that he can wake us up to who we truly are, the beloved sons and daughters of God. That's what it's really all about. It's not about us. It's about God loving us and dwelling in us. And that's why he comes. And so I think as we continue here on this sixth Sunday of Easter, as we begin this ascension time into the coming of the Spirit, just be more awake. Listen to yourself today. Listen to your life experience. And does it tell you that you believe you're the offspring of God? And that everything that's happening in your life experience today is done through the God in whom we live and move and have our being. If not, you're missing the point in the good news. Jesus promised that whenever we gather together in faith, Abba, our Father, would listen to us, and so let us pray. First of all, let us pray for peace in our world and wherever people suffer from the violence and injustice and historic misunderstanding of others, let us pray to the Lord. Let's gather together in our hearts and pray for those people who need the healing power of the Lord Jesus, mentally, emotionally, physically, spiritually, or relationally. For them, let us pray to the Lord. I'd like to pray for all the members of the Little Flower Society and for all people who support the life and ministries of the Carmelites here and throughout the world. Let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray for all people who are suffering from natural disasters right now, not only in our own country, but throughout the world, that somehow the rest of the human race might always respond to their needs, and that we really address the climate change that is changing our life experience. Let us pray to the Lord. And in silence, let us pray for our own private and personal intentions. For them, let us pray to the Lord. And for ourselves, that we really have become to a deeper awakening and awareness of that we are the offspring of God, and that our life experience is lived in God, in whom we live and move and have our being. Let us pray to the Lord. Gracious and faithful God, thank you for always listening to us. And we ask you to continue to manifest your presence in our life by responding to the needs that we place here before you and those that lie unspoken in the silence of our hearts. And we ask you this through Christ our Lord. Amen. I got to tell you earlier today, yesterday and then this morning when we had community mass, when I saw we're going to the Areopagus, I said, I'm going to be there. And I said, oh my God, I won't be able to climb up there. You know, I haven't been there in 10 years, you know. And even last time, 10 years ago, because I was too fat to climb up there. Now I got to get up here with a broken back. It's going to be fun. As we are, gifts are brought to the altar, and we take up a collection for the maintenance of the shrine. Can we do number 383? Start with verse 2.
Will you leave yourself behind if I but call your name? Will you care for cruel then never be the same? Will you raise the hostile's dead? Should your life or scare? You let me answer prayer in you and you in me. Will the blinded see if I but call your name? Prisoners free and never be the such as the sun seen, and you live to what I need you. And my sisters and brothers, let us pray that our sacrifice may be acceptable to the Holy One, our God. O God, who by this wonderful exchange effected in the sacrifice, have made us partakers of the one supreme Godhead. Grant, we pray, that as we have come to know your truth, we may make it our own by living a worthy way of life. And we ask you this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just. It is our duty and our salvation at all times to acclaim you, O Lord. but at this time above all to praise you yet more gloriously as Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. Through him the children of light rise to eternal life, and the halls of the heavenly kingdom are thrown open to the faithful. For his death is our ransom from death, and his rising and in his rising the life of all has risen. And therefore, overcome with Easter joy, every land and every people exalts in your praise. And even the heavenly powers and the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth." And you are indeed holy, O Lord, and all that you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and by the power and working of your Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make us holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. And therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by that same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts that we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For we remember and give thanks that on the night before he was betrayed, that Jesus himself took bread into his hands, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing. He broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." And we remember and give thanks that in that same way, that before that supper was was ended, that Jesus took the chalice. And once more giving you thanks, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sin may be forgiven. And do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord. And therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of his saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. And look, we pray, upon this offering of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, and grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. And may he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Joseph, her husband, with the apostles, the blessed apostles, the glorious martyrs, with Saint Therese, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. And Lord, may the sacrifice of our reconciliation advance the peace and the salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and in charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Daniel, our Bishop, and the entire people that you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned here before you. In your compassion, O most merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. And to our departed sisters and brothers, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom, for there we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. For we join in the sacrifice of Jesus, because we know, we believe, and we proclaim, through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. And as God has connected us in Christ, let's join with each other and pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lord, deliver us from all evil and from all fear, from whatever prevents us from knowing you and from loving one another. We ask for your mercy. We ask for your peace, so that we can live all of our days joyfully awaiting and experiencing the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and And Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles and to your friends, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church gathered here, and grant us the peace and the unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you. And let us offer each other some sign of Christ's peace. Peace the Lord be with you. Peace be with you. Peace the Lord be with you. Peace the Lord be with you. Lamb of God. This is Jesus, the Lamb of God, who has taken away the sin, darkness, and division of our world. This is Jesus who comes to us again to remind us that God is present in every breath and experience of our life. And blessed are we who are called to this banquet of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word.
Let us pray.
O Lord, graciously be present to your people and lead those that you have imbued with these heavenly mysteries to pass from a former way of life into a newness of life with a greater awareness that you are the God in whom we live and move and have our being. And we ask you this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And
may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and all days of your life. This Mass is ended. Let's go forth in peace and glorify the Lord by the way we live our lives. Our closing song will be 383. We'll do 4 and 5. 383. Will you love the you hide if I but call? Tell the fear inside and never be the same. Will you lift the heights you found? Reignite the world around. To my sight and touch and sound in you and you in me. Lord, your summons echoes true. When you but call my name, let me turn and follow you and never be the same. In your company I'll go, where your love and footsteps show. Thus I'll move and live and grow in